we would all stand, we're going to prayer. Heavenly Father, we're just here today to say thank you for doing for us what we can't do for ourselves, Lord. Lord, we're just here to say thank you for everything, the things we see, the things we don't see, Lord. Because, Lord, we are not confused, not really. Because we know it was your grace and mercy that got us this far, this day. And, Lord, we're going to be careful, Lord, to give you praise and to give you glory, God. Because you have been good to us. Because you have made a way out of no way. Because you have done for us what we could not do for ourselves. And Lord, we're going to be careful to give you praise and give you glory, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Now I want you to turn the word of the Lord to the book of Jude. The book of Jude. Jude is next to Revelation, sandwiched between 3 John and Revelation. Don't turn too quick, it's only one page. One-page book. Amen. You like the town I was born in. If you drive too fast, you'll miss it. Amen. You wonder, I saw the sign, but where's the town? That was it, where the sign was. Amen. Book of Jude. In the book of Jude, I'm going to call our attention to verse 15. We're going to read down through the 20th verse. You can stand with me and read that. Verse 14, where the Lord reads, "And Enoch also, the seventh from Adam, prophesied of these, saying, Behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints to execute judgment upon all and to convince all that are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds which they have ungodly committed and of all their hard speeches which ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust, and their mouth speaketh great swelling words, having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. But, beloved, remember ye the words which were spoken before the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ, how that they told you there should be mockers in the last time, who should walk after their own ungodly lust. These be they who separate themselves, sensual, having not the Spirit. But ye, beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost," in verse 21, "keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life." Keep yourselves, verse 21, in the love of God. Reach over and tell somebody, keep yourself.
Keep yourself.
Tell somebody else, keep yourself.
Keep yourself.
You may be seated. I know we sing that song, he's a keeper. And he is a keeper. But you have to keep yourself. In fact, this text, written in Jude, reflects a prophecy, one of the few that we hear, concerning Enoch. Enoch was the one who was so close to God. Called the seventh from Adam in genealogy. But Enoch prophesied, saying the Lord would come with 10,000 of the saints. You don't find much written about Enoch because Genesis tells us that he was so close with God. One day he took a walk and walked with God and walked all the way into glory. God did a miraculous transition on him and changed him from mortal to immortality. And he was able to live with God forever. But he left this on record. The Lord is coming. Tell somebody, the Lord is coming.
The Lord is coming.
It's still the same, and the testimony is still right. The Lord is coming. The church cannot neglect its duty to let men and women know Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
Amen, somebody. Amen. It sounds like such a story that we've heard in the religious circles for so long that sometimes we forget the reality of it, and we always talk about one day, one day, one day. But I want you to know we have indications. We have some indicators of that type of day when the Lord would come. And we just read it, and you can look at it here in the text. When he comes, he's coming to execute judgment and to convince all those that are ungodly that they need to be repentant. In fact, he comes to let them know that your deeds and the things you've done and your hard speeches that you've spoken against him will be held in contempt. You see, you got to watch people and stand back, watch for the lightning bolt, parenthetical lightning bolt, not the physical lightning bolt. But you know, something's got to happen when people continue to rail against God, continue to deny the God of their salvation, continue to tell you you're crazy for believing the Bible. You're crazy for believing in Jesus. You've lost your mind to believe in an unseen God, that he's going to come from the sky and with angels and take people out of here, raise the dead. You must have lost your mind. You know, it's interesting when the creature becomes smarter than the creator. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
When the creature thinks the creature knows more than the one who created it. It's like us parents when our children get 5 or 6 and learn how to formulate a few words, and they're exercising their gift of knowledge and their wisdom and their strength, and they'll argue with you. That's where we are with God when we want to tell him about his work and about his will and about what's going on in his life. Our God is our creator, and he knows his business, and he left a record for us in the Word of God. And the point of the Bible, the point of the Word, is to remind you that he is coming back. It started in the book of Enoch. Enoch was the first to let you know the Lord is going to come back. And he is going to come. Our Sunday school lesson was about judging. He is the judge of judges. He is the one that will divide the right from the wrong, the evil from the good. Somebody shout amen.
Amen.
And when you hear these hard speeches, there is no hell, there is no heaven. Or everybody's going to heaven. Everybody's going to hell. When you hear those hard speeches that no person of intelligence could believe an ancient book, when you hear those hard speeches, remember Jude, verse 15, where the Lord says he's going to come and deal with them that have spoken against him. Who are these people? They're murmurers. There are no murmurers in the church, are there? They are complainers. Always find something wrong. Ain't nothing right. Too hot, too cold. I can't come to church because it's raining. It's snowing today. I ain't going out. Oh, no, it's too busy. I got to work tomorrow. Who said you got to work tomorrow? Who said you got to have strength to work tomorrow? Who said that you have to have breath for tomorrow? Oh, Lord. Complainers. They walk after their own lust. They walk after how they feel. It's your thing. 1970s, do what you want to do. They walk after their own lust, create their own way. I don't believe this. I got a connection with God. I got a special relationship. You watch people that are special. People that are special are generally on the brink of needing medication. On the brief, there's something going on the inside that they're not telling you on the outside, and as a result, they feel justified bringing, you know, that automatic weapon to work because they're special.
Come on, Bishop.
There's a lot of special people in the world, but they believe they have a pathway to God that the world doesn't know. Nobody else understands this because, you know, me and God, we got this thing going here.
So I can do what I want to do, live how I want to live, say what I want to say, go to church when I want to, don't believe in church if I don't want to believe in it, and I'm still going to be all right.
Somebody shout, help us, Lord. I need a talk back, church, this morning. I do better when you lubricate my word with amen, preach, pastor. Gotta slow down when I don't hear, because I gotta make sure you understand what I'm saying. As they said, make some noise in this place.
In fact, he calls their words swelling words. And people hold them in admiration because they seemingly have an advantage over others. But beloved, somebody say, but beloved. Remember ye the words which were spoken before the apostles of the Lord Jesus Christ. You got to remember what the Lord said. You've got to remember what you've been taught since you were a child up. You've got to remember what you learned since you came to Christ. Amen. And don't let anybody steal his word out of your heart. Nobody, nobody. Let nobody take the gospel of Jesus Christ out of your spirit. Don't adopt a lifestyle. Don't join up with anybody that can't get with your God.
Oh, y'all don't hear me today.
They're my friends. They're my friends. It's okay to have friends, but your friends have to be in common with your God. Because how can two walk together except they agree? I'm not talking about agree what's the favorite color. I'm not talking about agree what's the favorite political party. I'm talking about agreeing that Jesus is Lord. And there's none other before him. There's none other that can stand before him.
Your faith will get you in trouble with your friends and help you find out who your friends are.
Because you, beloved, have to remember what the Lord taught us. And what did he tell us? That in the last days, mockers, scoffers, people who criticize the faith, people say they don't believe, people say you're crazy, you're wasting your time. Why do you spend all that time in church? Why do you keep reading the same words over and over again? And they'll try to understand the Bible ain't changed. Why do you keep reading it? But what they don't understand is there is this entity that keeps the word alive. There is this character of God, this personality of God, this distinct personage of God called the Holy Ghost. And the Holy Ghost, if you're scared of the word ghost because you saw the movie, he's the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will give life to the word that you read. The Holy Spirit will give strength to the word that you read. And even though it's the same word, it'll give new meaning and new understanding every time you open it up and read it again. The Lord is my shepherd. Read it again. I shall not want. Read it again. He makes it. Read it again. And the more you read it, the more new insight and new understanding you get from it. So, beloved, watch out for the scoffers. Jesus told us in the last time they should come and they'll walk after ungodly lust. Yes. Things that the Bible, things that God himself has said that he hates. Amen. Scoffers, people that don't believe the word. And I know, and I will tell you this, the time will come in our nation and it won't be long. Amen. The time is coming where what preachers preach, the government will try to regulate. Hate speech is against the law. And hate speech should be against the law. Hate speech should only be permitted in one place. And that is in the church when we say we hate the devil. And one of the mothers of the church, my wife's church, used to sing this song, "Me and the devil had a tussle, but I won." Me and the devil had a tussle, but I won. Me and the devil, we don't agree. I hate the devil, and he hates me. Me and the devil had a tussle, and I won. Yeah, hate speech is wrong. You can't get out there and say, I hate Jews, and I hate blacks, and I hate whites, and I hate this one, and I hate that one. But the gospel of Jesus Christ, the doctrine of God, the thing that God hates, you gotta hate.
Somebody shout amen. You got to hate it even if it's unlawful to say it. But I love the word of God. And I love the church. And the church is going to tell the truth no matter who believes different. Amen, somebody. Amen, somebody. So they're going to walk in their own lust that are against God, and they'll separate themselves. Separate. What does that mean? Pull out, pull apart. Today, in the 21st century, we have Christian-named churches, pastors, preachers, who have separated themselves from the mainstream denominations in order to tell people who marry same sex you can be saved and in a same sex relationship. Okay. Let me just make sure y'all understand something. I'm going to preach against that whether you say amen or not. So because it's your cousin, your friend, your sister, your brother, y'all don't want to say amen, it's still true. They separate themselves, not just on the sexuality issue. Separate themselves based on a slim philosophy of the text. Group that believe that you're not saved unless you handle a serpent. Because one scripture says, these signs shall follow them that believe. That what? In my name? And it skip on down and says, they shall take up serpents, and if they bite them, they will not harm them. And so they separate themselves on that verse and believe that part of your Christian walk ought to be able to pick up a snake. Deacon Charles, bring the box of snakes in with you. Oh, we don't have those. I just want to make sure y'all understood that. Separate themselves based on vain philosophies. What style clothes you like, so they separate themselves. Based on philosophy, what kind of music you like, so they separate themselves. Based on what kind of hairstyle they like, so they separate themselves. But anytime you see separation in the kingdom, it's ungodly.
And it's not of God. Somebody shout amen. These are signs of the last days. In fact, he describes them as sensual, sensitive to the world's needs, but having not the Spirit. Don't have the Holy Ghost. Ask your neighbor, do you have it? Do you have it? What is it? The Holy Ghost is the power of God that enables you to understand his word. It is the power of God that enables you to have strength to stand when everybody else is standing against you. Amen. Y'all don't hear me today. You need power to keep yourself in this world. It's getting harder and harder for people to testify the truth of Jesus Christ. Amen. Truth is, Holy Ghost can do what no treatment program can do. Holy Ghost can change your appetite. Holy Ghost can change your likes and your dislikes. The Holy Ghost can help you walk upright and live a pure and holy life. Somebody shout amen. But those that are simply human and sensitive to humanity separate themselves and say, you all right, we're all going to be saved by grace. It's going to be nothing but grace and mercy is going to keep us anyway. We all God's children, and we all sin, and we all are in error, and he is going to forgive us all. But beloved, you got to remember what Jesus said. Yes. Believe God. Build up yourself. Build up yourself. Build up yourself. Let me ask you a question. Which Schwarzenegger would you want to look like? There was the bodybuilder Schwarzenegger that was chosen for that very popular movie series. Y'all remember Terminator? Looked like a machine. That's because he kept building on himself. Kept building, I think some steroids too, but he kept building.
and build it. But as he got older and got into politics, he moved away from the bodybuilding. And what happens when you quit building? Look at his then and look at his now.
Okay, y'all don't want to tell the truth. I'm just telling the truth. I ain't hating on him.
But unless you keep on building, you won't be able to withstand in this evil day. Unless you keep on building, you'll fall prey to the enemy. Unless you keep on building, you'll lose your grip and won't be able to hold on.
I know you said I got saved back in the day, and so I'm going to be okay till Jesus comes.
You made up with your mind and you made a good determination, but you got to work on it. You got to do something for yourself. And the word says, look, beloved, we're not against you. That's why he keeps using the word beloved. He's talking hard stuff, but he uses the company word like, dear believer, my lovely child, people of God whom we love. You got to work on yourself. You got to make up in your mind that you're not satisfied with you as you are. You're not pleased with yourself. Lord, I appreciate your grace. I appreciate your mercy, but I want to be closer. I want to be stronger. I want to walk better. I want to talk better. I want to live a better life.
Beloved,
build up yourself on your most holy faith. Build up yourself on what? Your most holy faith. All of us got some holy faith. But you got to build on the holiest and strongest base that you have.
What is holy faith? Mary, the mother of Jesus. She birthed a child through faith. Joseph, earthly father, he had enough faith to keep Mary and believe that what she carried was of the Lord. That's holy faith. Faith for your healing. That's holy faith. Yes, it is. Yes, faith to believe God can work miracles. That's holy faith. But you know, miracle faith is not saving faith. Healing faith is not saving faith. You can follow people who follow faith healing. They go for the healing, but they don't go to learn how to live right every day.
Get up on the platform, lay his hands on you, you can fall out under the anointing, and get up and go back and still don't have power to quit cool.
Am I preaching today?
You're beloved. He loves you even if you're smoking. He loves you even if you drink sometimes. He loves you even if you mess up, but you gotta keep working on yourself.
You gotta get rid of the black book. It's electronic now. It's in your phone. You got to start saying, I don't need this one no more. And I don't need that one no more. Y'all don't even know what I'm talking about. Yes, you do. I don't have to go that route anymore. I got a better life. And I'm working on it. So I need to choose the strongest foundation that I can find. I need to choose the strongest word of faith that I can get. And I need what the church gave us because a storm is coming.
Brother Daniel, gospel singer Daniel Brown said there's a storm out over the ocean. And it's moving this way. And if your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you, tell somebody you, will surely drift away. I know you say, I ain't never going to be drifting away, child. No, no. I'm over here to stay till I die. But you got to find a way to hold on. And what you hold on to must be the rock of Jesus Christ.
You know, it's building time. And you don't build, Rome wasn't built in a day. And you're not going to be built in a day. But you ought to be able to see your progress. When I look back over my life, see where the Lord brought me from. Some of us are scared to look back. Hallelujah.
You ought to look back every now and then and measure yourself and find out, have you moved anywhere from where you were the day you met the Lord?
The world is right.
Why are you going to church? You ain't living no better. The world is right. Why you said Jesus saved and you ain't living a saved life? The world is right. Why can't you say that Jesus will keep you? Well, why aren't you careful? Well, I can't blame Jesus. He did his part. Oh, y'all ain't talking back to me today. Can't blame the church. The door's still open. The preacher's still preaching. You can't even blame the prayer warriors. They're still praying. My question is, what are you doing? I'm looking at your spiritual hands and they're awful smooth. I don't see no calluses. Looking at your knees, they're awful smooth. They look like you spend any time in prayer. Y'all don't hear me today. You got to make up in your mind, I got to work on me. Bishop Amos can't save me. Mother Mayo and Mother Peacock, they can't save me in the glory. Other deacons can't take me there in Sunday school. I've got to get there for myself. Responsibility has shifted. And I'm telling you, there's a shift now going on. Years ago, the church took responsibility for everything in your life. We told you what not to do and what to do, where to go, where not to go. You were held accountable. If you came in late, you couldn't testify, you couldn't sing. If you missed a prayer meeting, you had to have a meeting with the pastor. Why? Because the church was trying to keep you and trying to lock you down so that when Jesus came, you could be bound, rooted, and grounded in the truth. But I'm going to tell you something, shift has come. We get closer to Revelation. Jude has found himself having to tell the church, get yourself together. Get yourself together. Get yourself together. Why? Because Jesus is coming. Don't wait on the church. People say, church ain't what it used to be. Church ain't like it used to be. It can't be. It'll never be. It's an entertainment zone. Sing me happy. Preach me happy. Make me shout. I don't know if the spirit is there if they can make me shout. But the church is not here to make you shout. Sorry, bust that bubble. The church is not here to make you happy. I know you saw the Blues Brothers movie, they flipped down the aisle. You may never flip. Probably best if you don't. But it ought to bring a change in your life. You ought to be able to walk out those doors having heard something that pricked your heart and made you say, I've got to do better. I've got to build myself. I've got to start building some blocks and building my house because there's a leak in this old building, Sister Gail. 58 starts leaking. And my soul has got to move to a building not made by hand. We're going to leave here. And if you're here when Jesus comes, you still need to have something built up. Do you know how to pray? It's a rhetorical question. Don't answer out loud. But do you know how to intercede for anybody? Do you know how to call on the name of the Lord and pray and push until something happens? Do you know what it means to have breakfast with the Lord? That's an old church saying, we're going to have breakfast with the Lord today. That means mama ain't cooking. We fasting and praying today. The Lord. I tell you there's a shift because y'all don't turn your phones off. You might put them on silent, but every one of y'all probably got it on right now. And the funniest thing that happens to me, the funniest thing I think is just comical. When a person's in a meeting or in a session and their phone rings, they're answering and say, I'm in a meeting and I can't talk right now. If you can't talk, why you answering? Y'all see that? Hey, I'm on the bus and I ain't supposed to be on my phone. I'll call you back. And the church I'm going to do better after a while.
Everybody waiting on after a while. Somebody shout after a while.
After a while.
I'm going to get better after a while. I'm going to do better after a while. I pick on new people. Terrell, I'm going to do better after a while. If I after a while, Lord, I'm going to get it together after a while. But I know January, February, March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, and I ain't seen the month of after a while yet. Today is the day of your salvation. Today is the Lord nearer than he ever was. The day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart. You don't have a tomorrow. You don't have an after a while. You got to do it now. You got to do it now. You got to do it now. Beloved, it's not an angry message. It's why we keep saying, beloved, look, we're not mad at you. We just want you to do better. Tell somebody, the church ain't mad. Jesus ain't mad. The Holy Ghost ain't mad. He just wants you to do better. Tell somebody, do better. Build yourself on your most holy faith. And then, it's in your Bible, verse 20. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Drop the phone. Pray in what? How many are getting ready to leave here from church and going to ride away in your Rolls? Rolls Royce. Oh, you can't? So you can't pray in your Rolls. Because you don't have a Rolls. Okay, I just was going to check that. You can't pray in your limousine, Barbara, if you don't have a limousine. Now, praying in your Cadillac is possible if you got one. The problem the church has, what they call praying, tired of pastor. What they call praying in the Holy Ghost is praying in the flesh. And I was in a session, and the preacher said, I want everybody to pray in the Holy Ghost. And everybody start in their glossolalia. That's what sanctified churches call other people who speak in tongues. Glossolalia. We don't use that term in the Holy Church. We call it speaking in tongues. They think it means speaking in tongues, praying in the Holy Ghost. Come on, let's pray in the Holy Ghost. And they say, oh, no. How are you going to pray in the Holy Ghost and you can't get in his car? To pray in the Holy Ghost means you got to have.
I'm working too hard today, brother. I'm working too hard today.
You got to have him on the inside in order for you to get in here. And I just want you to know the shift is coming, and there's an imitation spirit in the land. There's an anti-Christ spirit in the land, and you see people doing motions.
And the word says they're wells without water. You've got to look.
But in order to pray in the Holy Ghost, you got to give the Holy Ghost a place to live. Just like you're in Christ, puts Christ in you. When you get in the Holy Ghost gets in you. In order to get there, beloved, you got to build up your most, on your most holy faith. You got to move up a little bit higher.
Thank you, Mahalia Jackson.
You got to move up
a little higher.
Oh, yeah, I'm talking to you. I'm preaching to every one of you. Can't be life as usual. Can't be business as usual. Can't be prayer meeting as usual. Going through your daily routine and living like you want to live and believe that Sunday morning sanctifies you.
Hello, somebody.
Well, Pastor, I'm working on it. What are you doing? How are you working on it? What changes are you making?
He said, I'm going to clean that room one day. I'm going to clean that room. I got to get to it.
The only way to get to it is to get busy. A hot day like today, a lot of people going swimming. They'll go to the pool. And the wrong thing to do is to just put your foot in the water. You know why? Woo, it's cold. I didn't get it there. It's cold. Even on a hot day, you put your foot in the water. Oh, that water's cold. The only way you're going to get in, you just got to.
I thought you knew.
You just got to jump in. If you want the blessings of God, you want the anointing of God, you got to make up in your mind. I got to get in. I don't want to miss out. I want him to cover me from head to toe because I want to be on the inside of this relationship with God. Somebody shout glory.
Glory.
Too long we've been on the outside. Too long we've been on the outskirts. Too long we've been looking through the window. And the Lord is saying, you better get in, man, and learn how to build up your faith and learn how to pray in the Holy Ghost.
Praying in the Holy Ghost.
Praying in the Holy Ghost means you pray, but you say, not my will, but your will be done. Not my way, but your way, Lord.
I want everybody to repeat these four ways, four words with me.
Have
your
way,
Lord.
You mean it, and when you believe it, and when you keep saying, have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Have your way, Lord. I know I'm not what I ought to be, but have your way, Lord. I know I'm not where I ought to be, but have your way, Lord. I know I'm not doing what I ought to do, but have your way, Lord. Because I know if you have your way, I'll find myself climbing up just a little bit higher. But I look around and I see I've been here for a little while now, but have your way, Lord. I pray in the spirit, I mean it from my heart. Have your way, Lord. Shine the light from heaven on my soul. If you find anything that shouldn't be, take it out. Take it out. Why? Because I want to go
higher.
I want to go higher. Lord, I want to go higher in anointing. I want to go higher in glory. I want to get closer to the Word of God.
But you got to pray
in the Holy Ghost. And in order to pray in the Holy Ghost, you've got to invite the Holy Ghost to come in your life. You've got to say, have your way. Not my will, because you read in Jude about those that follow their own lust. But I don't want to follow my opinion. I don't want to follow my wants and wishes. Lord, I want to follow your will, and I want you to take me where you want to take me.
I got a responsibility. Praying in the Holy Ghost. Start with saying,
have your way, Lord.
Finally, keep yourself in the love of God. Keep yourself in the love of God. The military started a program years ago called the buddy plan. That was you could sign up with somebody else. And they promised you could always be together. But you know what? They didn't keep that word. You and your cousin, you and your brother, you and your partner joined, and one went this way and one went that way. I'm sorry, military people, but it's true. Well, the plan changed. The promise changed. The need changed. But now, something you gotta do for yourself. Keep yourself. Keep
yourself in church. Keep yourself on the altar. Keep yourself from the world. Keep yourself from things that are not like God. Sanctify yourself, and the very God of peace will sanctify you. Holy, W-H-O-L-L-Y. Keep yourself from things that take you down. Tell somebody, keep yourself. The church won't keep you. The preacher won't keep you. The deacons can't keep you. You need to keep yourself. And when the brother and those that Jude was talking to see to understand what he was talking about, he concludes his letter by saying, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling. If you'll keep yourself, he'll keep you from falling. If you're willing to do something for yourself, he will stand right there with you. And though you stumble, he'll catch you before you fall. Though times get hard, he'll be right with you even in the second and third tribulation. Though the enemy come, he will keep you.
You got to be willing to be kept.
You got to show him you're doing something for yourself. I hear you. How much interest are they paying on savings in that bank?
Well, how much interest are they paying over here that way? Oh, my. I know a bank that get better than that.
If you got no money, it doesn't matter. You can't jump over to Jude 24, 25 and skip 17 to 21. Hello? Everybody want to get to now unto him that is able to keep me from falling. He will keep you. But before he told you that he will keep you from falling, he told you to keep yourself. Keep yourself. And so now let me testify. No matter what y'all say or do, I'm going to keep on praying. No matter who likes it or doesn't like it, I'm going to keep on preaching. No matter what they say about me, how they talk about me, I'm going to keep on holding on. I'm going to keep on saying, yes, Lord. Have your way, Lord. Save me again, Lord. Have your way in my heart. Have your way in my home. I got to keep myself. Hallelujah.
Oh, Lord. Keep me. We put it all on the Lord. Lord, me day by day in a pure and perfect way. What's wrong with that, son?
You gotta keep yourself.
Tell three people, you gotta keep yourself. There's a shift. There's a shift in the kingdom. Time ain't long. Jesus is soon to come. The scripture says he winked at our ignorance in the early days, which means he overlooked it. He bypassed it. But you know better now. Tell somebody, you know better now. They said, well, in those days, everybody couldn't read. You don't even have to read the Bible anymore. You can play it on your phone. You know better now. You got to find a way to get in the Holy Ghost. You got to find a way to get in the Spirit of God. And I'm going to tell you, don't be caught up by the crowds. Don't be caught up by the thousands. There was a saying that says the downward road is crowded, with unrepentant soul. Crowded.
Jesus said, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way that's going to lead unto salvation, unto righteousness. Means that there's a price to pay.
It's going to feel tight after a while. Somebody shout glory. Y'all off a quiet on me today.
It means you're going to feel the pressure of your salvation. If you have never felt the pressure of righteousness, the pressure of being kept, the pressure of holding on, then you better check yourself. No matter how long you've been saved, every now and then the enemy will pull on you. And you got to jump into battle and say, no, 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 I've come too far. I've been through too much. I've gone through too many dangers, toils, and snares to give up now. I see where I come from. I'm in the Super Bowl of my life, and I see the goal. I got the ball in my hand, and I'm running to my goal, and I can't let nobody stop me. I've come too far, been through too much, had too much pain, too much suffering. The life that I had, I gave it up, and I'm definitely not going back. Don't somebody testify with me, I'm not going back. I'm not going back. I'm not going back.
I'm going to keep myself. Come here, Jesus. Put your arm. What Jesus will do for you is he'll be there. Oh, I felt that. I must have been drifting back, so I felt that. Now, he ain't going to force me, but oh, I can feel his presence. As long as I can feel him nearby, I must be in a safe zone. It might get dark sometimes. As long as I can hear his voice and feel his presence and sense that he's near, I must be doing all right. But if I get out there and I can't find him nowhere, something went wrong. Keep on talking, Jesus. Keep on talking, Jesus. I may not be able to see him, but I sure can hear him. I hear his voice, and I gotta keep myself. I can't afford to go out into the rebellious darkness. I can't afford to the very end, and I got him. I ain't gonna let him go now. I ain't gonna let him go. Make up in your mind, I'm gonna hold on. It's personal. It's personal. I'm going to invite everyone to come to the altar. Everyone. If you can't be able to walk, if you physically can do it, come on. One particular scripture says, all we like sheep have gone astray. Everybody messes up sometimes. Everybody slips sometimes. Everybody needs refreshing. Sometimes. Somebody shout something. Doesn't mean that you're not here. This whole text was written to the people of the kingdom. And throughout, Jesus kept saying, beloved, beloved. He never rebuked anybody, did he? Beloved, beloved, beloved of God, beloved, 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 beloved. Perhaps somebody in there was high while he was talking to him, but he still said, beloved. Somebody had messed up, perhaps wanted to have a therapy session and said, I need to talk to somebody. No, beloved, what you need to do is hold on. What you need to do is revisit the thing that caught you. Revisit the thing that saved you. I don't know what your background is. I don't know what your spiritual background is, what kind of church you went to, but if it's the Bible-believing church, if no matter what denomination, if the word of God was preached, you got something in you that will still grow in you and will still help you, will still keep you, it'll still fortify you. Hallelujah, because his word, I said this yesterday, his word is like a little leaven, and a little leaven will leaven the whole lump. Just get a little bit in you, and that thing will grow.
gotta be willing to do something for yourself. I'm gonna pray with you, pray over you, but you need to pray for you. I said I'm gonna pray with you, and I'm gonna pray over you, but you need to pray for you, because it's a shift. Nobody out there can keep you. But ma'am, those days of the old saints keeping folks, that's gone. Y'all understand what I'm saying by keeping? Maybe your dress too short. Sir, you need to know, don't come to his dress like that. No, you know, that's not what we do. Come to your house and look at your refrigerator. You got beard, the devil is like, get rid of that. I ain't checking your refrigerator. I ask for a ride to your car and it smells like Winston's, Cool and Marlboro. I ask for the ride. I'm not going to get in your car and criticize your car. Hello? You got to make up for your mind for yourself. It's the day of individual accountability. I'm asking everyone to be accountable to God for yourself. Will you bow your head? Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the text that tells us to keep ourselves. Thank you for clarity and understanding. I understand it better now. And it sounds like to me I need to be sure the Holy Ghost is at work in my life. Because I build myself up by praying in the Holy Ghost. And I heard my pastor say, just ask God to have his way. Have your way, Lord. Because your way will be the right way. Have your way, Lord. Your way will be the keeping way. Have your way, Lord. Your way will be the strength way. Have your way, Lord. Your way will overcome every other way that's not like you. So today, Lord, I ask you to forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my sins. Don't be too bold. Don't be too strong. Don't be too resistant to say it. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me and I'll be clean. Purge me and I will be thoroughly clean in the inside. Have your way in me. I accept you as my Lord. I accept you as my Savior. I commit to keep myself. And I know you will keep me from falling. Now take a moment and praise him for that. Come take a moment and praise him for that. Take a moment and praise him for that. Take a moment and praise him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your touch. Thank you for loving me when I was unlovable. Thank you for keeping me when I was unkeepable. Thank you for restoring me when I needed restoration. Thank you, Jesus. I thank you right now. I thank you from the depth of my heart. I thank you out of my soul. I thank you in my mind and my heart. And from this day forward, I will keep myself.
And I give you the glory. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Look at me, saints. Every one of you that prayed that prayer, that meant it in your heart, just raise your hand. I mean, you really meant it. I want Jesus to keep me. Thank you. Thank you. Well, I didn't mean to deceive you. But if you meant what you said, that means he saved you. See, you saved yourself through your own confession. For with the confession, the mouth, the man confesses of his sin and believes in his heart. And if you have confessed and believed, that's called salvation. Now what you do with it is up to you. Doesn't that make sense? How you go beyond August 5th, that's up to you. But I do know this. Jude finished and said, now unto him that's able to keep you. He's able to keep you. He's able to keep you. He's able, brothers, sisters. He's able to keep you. And he'll keep you from falling. He'll keep you from falling. I know down in the church, good friend, in a meeting, he's sitting and laughing, talk together. I sing his song, but I disagree with it. We fall down, but we get up. Why are you falling? I know we've fallen, but why are you falling down if he's able to fall?
that means you didn't do something on your part. If you fell down, don't be down when he finds you. Anybody ever fall on the ice? Of course we fall on the ice. Hey, this is Indiana. And her mama fell the other day. Man, she didn't tell me. But when I saw her, she was up. Amen. I know we fall, but when I see you, I want you up. When you come to the Lord's house, make up your mind. I'm up. I fell, but I'm up. I had a problem, but I'm up. I had trouble, but I'm up. Tell somebody, I'm up now. I'm up now. Amen. I'm just going to walk more carefully. I'm going to be more careful, more circumspect in my walk. I'm going to be a little more tripping, a little more cautious. I'm going to watch more carefully. And that's what you have to do to keep yourselves watching them carefully. Jesus met with his disciples, and on that day when he met, it was the day before his crucifixion, also the day before one of the great holiest days in all of the Jewish Hebrew history. And Jesus said, this is the last time I'll be able to do Passover with you. He said, but you all will be able to continue it, but as often as you do it in remembrance of me. We celebrate the Lord Jesus' sacrifice every first Sunday in this church, and we offer to everyone who has accepted the Lord as Savior to receive this today. Why? Because it is a living testimony and throughout all the Christian churches all over the world that we are the baptized body of believers in Jesus Christ. So we accept the bread and the wine as his body and his blood in a figurative context, saying that we have taken him in our hearts and in our lives. Amen? Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for this opportunity to receive this sacrament. We ask that you bless the bread and the wine. Bless that we receive, for we receive it in Jesus' name. Let it be healing for our bodies, deliverance for our soul, peace in our mind, unity in the body of Christ. In your name we pray. Amen.
So strong.